great to have all of you here tonight for our talk on header bidding, an important, exciting, and at times controversial topic. I would also like to welcome all of you to AppNexus. For those of you who don't know, we are an internet technology company in the advertising space, and we are powering much of the open internet for monetization. We also have a broader vision of creating a better internet for consumers, for publishers, and for advertisers. This is our Razzle space, which when the company was much younger was used for internal learn and teach events, smaller tech talks, and more recently we've opened it up to the broader community in New York here. We're really glad to have you here. This is a community, the Prebid community, so it's very fitting. And so thank you again for coming tonight. We have a pretty exciting lineup of speakers for this evening's talk, including Matt Kendall, who's from our Conshohocken, Pennsylvania office, also known as Conchi. He's an engineering manager and is one of the lead developers behind Prebid, which you'll be hearing about here tonight, and also worked on something called the AppNexus seller tag. And we also have Nate Cozy, a software engineer from our Portland, Oregon office, also playing a key role on the Prebid project. And yours truly, Eric Hoffert. I'm our SVP of Video Technology and have also been collaborating on our Prebid initiative. We also, for today, have a pretty power-packed agenda. We want to set some context, especially for those of you for whom header bidding may be new or unfamiliar territory, just to give you some pointers and talk about the landscape for ad tech. But we'll quickly dive in through Matt's talk into header bidding technology, how it works, what it's made of, and also where it's headed next. He will also have a demo for you of display header bidding and how that works. And then Nate is gonna walk us through a really interesting aspect of Prebid, which is the use of functional programming in JavaScript. So I think you are likely to find that intriguing. And he'll also walk you through what has been going on for the last year in the life of the Prebid project. It started out as a very small initiative, and in a pretty rapid time frame has blossomed to become a strong ecosystem in the ad tech space. Yours truly, then, will talk about the new kid on the block, which is server-to-server header bidding, which you may have heard about quite a bit lately, and the even newer and shinier kid on the block of video header bidding, which is bringing the world of video to header bidding. And that will also include some hopefully cool live demos, and we'll do Q&A to wrap it up. So that gives you a sense of what we're planning to cover here today. It's worth noting that header bidding has caused a lot of buzz in the industry. People have called it the end of the publisher waterfall, which some people have said is kind of a slow way to generate ad demand that can impact the internet in an adverse way, and at the same time not get top dollar for publishers for the content they want to author and create on the web. Other people have called it a secret war against Google. Other people have said it's not a secret war against Google. Some people have said, WTF, what is this header bidding? Help me make sense of this. There's a lot of complexity. What is this ad tech stuff? So we hope to both not only demystify this for you this evening, but actually really take you into a lot of the core components that are driving prebid.org, which is an open source initiative, and header bidding more broadly. It's worth mentioning that in the relatively brief period of 18 months since Prebid started and header bidding has come into effect, header bidding really has changed everything in this particular space. And that's especially true with an open architecture and with an open source platform, which is how Prebid was built. For those of you, again, who don't know, RTB stands for real-time bidding, and this is happening 5 million times a second, for example, for AppNexus, bidding on impressions to get the top dollar for publishers. The challenge is when you combine that functionality with ad serving, for example, for Google's DFP product, if you're familiar with that, and there are other ad servers out there, it tends to be more of a black box And so getting the actual top dollar for the publisher has not been easy historically. So header bidding has sought to really fix that problem, crack it open, and essentially create an open, fair, and transparent auction environment for monetization. And at this point, I'd now like to actually introduce to you Matt Kendall, who's going to walk you through more of the details behind header bidding, how it works, and how Prebid relates. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Eric. As Eric said, I'm Matt Kendall, and I'm engineering manager here at AppNexus. Thanks all for coming tonight. I'm going to be talking about header bidding and Prebid.js. Before I get into that, I'd like to give you a brief introduction to how I started in working in header bidding and header bidding technology. So flash back to a year and a half ago, and a product manager named Paul Yang decided to come and visit me in the Conshohocken, Pennsylvania office where I work. And I'd never met Paul before. He's a very energetic guy. And he was like, hey, what do you think about header bidding? And I'm like, well, what's header bidding? And so he sent me an AppExchanger link. And I read that and some other information. And I was like, all right, this is kind of cool. He's like, what do you think about putting some tech out there in the open source community for sponsored by AppNexus that would be a header bidding wrapper? And I said, oh, well, that sounds interesting too. So we spent the next 2 days kind of locked in a room and banging out like what an API would look like as far as for methods that might be useful in a wrapper, and the end result was Prebid.js. So towards the end of the 2 days, Paul asked me, he's like, hey, how long do you think this will take to build? And so not really knowing, and from the finest traditional sense for a developer, and then when you don't know the answer to an estimate, you just wait 2 to 3 weeks. So 4 weeks later, I did the initial commit to Prebid.js on GitHub, and that was, it wasn't ready, but I think that was the longest amount of time that Paul would wait for me to publish it. So I was like, all right, we're just going to put it out there. So fast forward back to today, we've learned a few things. One, we're still really terrible at estimating. Two, there's a lot of growth in the header bidding space and more to come. Just quick show of hands, who's familiar here with ad tech in general? Okay, pretty good group. So I'm going to talk really quickly about ad tech in general, and then we'll dive into some of the specifics of header bidding. So here's the 90-second version. Here we have a user, John. He's interested in sports and e-commerce, finance. He's visiting newyorktimes.com. On the markup of the page, it's rendering to the browser. There's an ad placement. At that point in time, an ad request is made to the ad server. An ad decision will be made based on this user and his interest, and we show the ad to the user. So that all sounds nice and simple until we expand the topology and look at what's going on behind the scenes. Well, there's a little bit more behind the ad server than we initially thought. We've got exchanges, which are marketplaces for buyers and sellers that are participating in this auction. We've got demand-side platforms. We've got agencies, direct bidders. There's a lot going on here. We've got data providers on the platform that are taking a look at the cookie and enriching it, trying to up the value of that impression that we see. And ultimately, we have an auction, as Eric talked about. There's an RTB auction here, and the highest bidder purchases that ad impression, and that ad is shown to the user. On the AppNexus platform, that's typically 120 milliseconds. So it's a lot going on in about a tenth of a second. So that's a lot of ad tech technology. What's a publisher to do when faced with declining ad revenue in this economic environment? They want to focus on running their business, not necessarily on ad tech technology. So we've got a couple of companies, maybe you heard of them, Google, Facebook. They're interested in solving that problem for the publisher at a cost. There is a potentially undisclosed revenue share model going on that may not be in the best interest of the publisher. So enter header bidding. It's a way that publishers can put more money back into their pockets. Header bidding, as Eric described earlier, is an auction that can be run directly in the browser. Here we have an example of a header bid unit that's being requested with three different bidders. There's a $10 CPM bid, a $6 CPM bid, and a $8.50 CPM bid. And we would run the auction right there in the browser. When we received the bids, the top bid would be picked, and then it would be sent on to a final ad server where an RTB auction can happen. And if that ad is picked, then it would be rendered to the page. So what we see here is we're adding demand to this equation. So more demand, more competition generally increases yield. Some publishers are seeing up to 40% lift in revenue, depending on the audience and such. Okay, so that's probably also sounding very complicated, and it can be. Early on, we looked at some of the challenges that publishers said they were having when they were trying to integrate header bidding onto their page. The first thing that we noticed was there's a lot of code running on the client side that they have to integrate, and not a lot of publishers have dedicated engineers to add such code to their page. So we identified that as a potential issue. Actually, some of the calls that we saw were synchronous on the page, so they were blocking everything else from loading, which is a bad user experience, which is what you can see on this network tab. Here we have a synchronous request being made, and all the other requests are waiting until it's done, till they can go, and it's this very, very serial waterfall. It's not great for performance or user experience. Additionally, if one of these ad servers never returns, they hang the whole page. So with that in mind, we decided to build Prebid.js. Prebid.js is an open source wrapper for publishers to quickly implement header bidding. The first thing that we did was we made it very easy for publishers to integrate on the page with a JSON-like structure for configuration so they can add and subtract bidders very easily. That's great for A/B testing. They can quickly add or remove a bidder as they see fit and see what runs best for them. We require all bidders to be asynchronous, so they're not going to block anything on the page, which is great for performance and also for decreasing latency. And then finally, as I said, it's open source, so you can see what's going on. We don't bias any bids or anything like that. It's a very clear and fair, transparent auction. Okay, so here to demonstrate, I have the algorithm we use to pick the winning bid. We have a pre-bid global on which a bids received object is an array. We're filtering the bid on ad unit code. So does this bid match the ad placement that we're requesting for? And then we do a reduce function, which it gets passed in a get highest bid CPM, which is simply an array sort function that sorts on bid CPM. And then we don't reduce to an empty bid. So if we get nothing, we get zero CPM bid. So, unbiased auction mechanics, check. So some of the things we were thinking about when we created Prebid.js, the first thing we wanted to do is make sure that it would be a small library because it's being included in publishers' pages. We didn't want to weigh anything down, not just because of the download and the latency that it would add, but also because when you're parsing JavaScript in the browser, that adds CPU cycles. So we wanted to minimize it as much as possible. We see typical builds are generally less than 35 KB gzipped, and that's possible because we have a process where you can include different bidders at build time. So if you're not using a subset of bidders, you can just exclude them from your final build. Again, we don't allow any synchronous calls, so everything is asynchronous. We also have a timeout function, so if any bidder is long running on the page, we simply time them out, and they don't participate in the given auction. One thing that I learned a long time ago working in tech support is that publishers looking at their pages are confused by various messages in the debug output on the browser. So what we do is we disable all that debug output unless the publisher specifically asks to turn it on, in which case they can see it, and I'll show that in the demo later. And the final thing is we test in as many browsers and platforms as possible. Today we're using a tool called Browser Stack, which allows us to emulate various devices and do testing through a semi-automated process. So we do that with each release to make sure everything's running smoothly as possible. Here's our current Prebid.js stats. Today, we're seeing 13 billion plus transactions on the AppNexus platform. We're running in 15,000 plus sites. We think the number's actually much higher than that, but this is the only number that we can track. It's hard to tell how many people are using it because it's open source and anyone can use it and build it as they see fit. We have over 100 contributors to the project today and 40 plus demand partners. Here's our build stack. We're using Node.js, Gulp.js for streaming, Webpack for bundling. Karma is our integration and unit test glue. Babel we use for transpiling and ES6 syntax, which is great for writing functional code. Nate's going to talk a little bit about that. So ES6, you know, is pretty new for some of the browsers out there, and we have polyfills that get automatically inserted, so we don't have to worry about certain things that aren't working in different browser environments. We have Travis CI integrated through GitHub, so when we get a PR request, if the build's not green, then we can just tell the contributor to go and fix that code before we take a look at it. Then we have some various tools, Istanbul for code coverage reporting, and ESLint for linting and style convention. Okay, so at this point, you're probably thinking, wait, you can't have a front-end JS talk without something. Aren't you missing React? Well, we don't actually use React in Prebid, mainly just because it's for building UIs in the front end, and we don't have a need for the UI. It's just JavaScript running. However, we do have another AppNexus-sponsored project called Lucid UI, which is based on React, and you can use it for building front ends. It's accessible on the AppNexus GitHub account if you want to check it out. So we talked about making this project open source, but I wanted to dig in a little bit about why we made it open source. It was, you know, we did choose that in the beginning, and we identified that a problem in the industry is trust, and publishers are including code to run directly on their page, and sometimes they don't know what is in that code or what it's doing. So we figured, let's just make it open so everybody knows what's going on, and that seemed to work out pretty well for us. And then as a side effect, some of the benefits, I guess you could say, of having it out there in the open is as soon as you make code changes, a bunch of people will go and test it and then tell you when things are broken, which is great. And then, you know, just innovation and quality. Like, I think just having something in open source, you inherently write better code and you get a wider audience to test ideas on, and then they also bring their own ideas, which is great. Some of the challenges that we've seen with running this project as open source, as it's grown, we've had to assign resources for monitoring and issues and management, which is a good problem to have, but it is something that you have to consider. We have to filter some of the noise that we get on the GitHub project, and we're working on making this better, but the process we have today, people just open issues if they have questions and things like that, so we're looking to make that better. It can be mitigated with good documentation, which we have great documentation on prebid.org, so that cuts that down a little bit. And question is this really open source? And the answer is yes, this is a fully open source project backed by AppNexus. We had that question a lot in the beginning, but now that's really driven by the community. Okay, at this point, I'm going to show you a quick demo of two different things. One is a tool called Headerbid Expert, which is a Chrome extension that can be used to check out different header bidding partners that are on a page. So I'm going to show you a quick demo of that. Here we have the extension. I've expanded it, and here on the page there is these different bidders: AOL, AppNexus, Index Exchange, Synobi, Sovereign, and what included on each bid partner here, you see the latency that it took down below for how long each bidder took, and then also you'll see the time it DFP took to load, which is the final ad server call made. And then there's some information about potential things that you could do to increase performance to make things better. In the case here, you might want to tighten the timeout so the ad server call is made earlier. The second thing I'm going to show you is the debug output with Prebid.js. Typically, that's all suppressed. The only thing you see here is that Prebid was loaded and the version is 0.18. However, if you put in this Prebid PBJS underscore debug equals true into your browser, then you will see a lot more information, such as the bidders that are being requested. Here's the different ones that we have on this auction. And then finally, you'll also see the output of the render ad call, which is if the bid actually won the final auction, we'll see that the ad was rendered with this render ad call. Okay, at this point, I'd like to welcome Nate to the stage to talk about functional programming and a refactor that we did in Prebid.js.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, everybody. My name is Nate Cozy. I'm delighted to be here and to see all of you. It's a great turnout. We are excited about this project, and we're excited to tell you guys about this project also. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the patterns that we used in building Prebid.js, including some functional patterns, some other sort of pattern-like things. And here I don't mean formal software design patterns necessarily, but just ways of approaching a problem. And I think that we've used some of these patterns. We've also discovered some of these patterns because in software engineering, we apply a pattern to a problem to better understand the problem. As we understand the problem more, the suitable patterns sometimes get more revealed to us than known in advance. So I actually find that pretty exciting, and that's happened for us on this project. I am ProtoNate on GitHub. Please say hello and check out the Prebid.js project there. I also have the great good fortune of working with a terrific team of people. Matt Jacobson in product, Matt Kendall, of course, our engineering manager. Matt Lane is a software engineer that works with me in Portland, Oregon. Jaimin Panchel is another engineer that works in the Conchi office. And we've mentioned our docs already. Rich Loveland is our docs person. He does a fantastic job. The success of Prebid would not be what it is today without great docs. So get great docs in your project. That's necessary. I also want to recognize He-Rei Paul Yang and Minky Jiang, who were, along with Matt, part of the original conversations that became Prebid.js. So I'm going to organize this talk. I started working on the Prebid project a year ago, January. So I'm just going to organize this a bit as a year in the life. And beginning with working on the Prebid project, taking the ad tech marketplace and all of these companies here that are competing with each other, collaborating with each other, lots of churn, lots of technology, innovation. And my question was, how does open source fit? Like, what's the pattern of applying open source to this environment? And initially it was that we have a standards body, the IAB, Interactive Advertising Bureau. They maintain some open source projects or some standards, like, for example, SafeFrame for using cross-domain iframes. So initially I thought, yeah, okay, that might be how Prebid wrapper around all these demand partners, that might be how this fits in. In February, the project is starting to get some real traction, and then we're getting written up in the news, not Prebid per se, but wrappers around header bidding at this point, and that we're going to end the waterfall of one auction passing off to another auction, passing off to another auction. Also, OpenX and some others at this point start talking about server-side header bidding. Just to give you an idea, like the client-side wrappers were just getting going, another step, and we're already, hey, what's the next thing? So that's the environment that we're working in. Despite that, one of the things that we did right off was say, this project is a going concern, and we don't have any tests. It's been a very rapid development cycle. We need to invest in putting in some developer support. So that was where our build stack started to get more robust, and where we started to talk about bringing in Babel so we could write in ES6. And then when we started talking about that, we started saying, well, why don't we look at doing some refactoring here? Because by March, with growth growing, our usage rate growing at doubling every month, we realized that if we wanted to do anything with this, any kind of changes, big changes, it was now or never. Either the project was going to fail, in which case it doesn't matter, and or the project was going to succeed, in which case we wouldn't really be able to change that much later down the road. It would be a lot harder to change down the road. So we took on a refactor. Some of the guiding principles, patterns, if you will, about our refactoring, you know, we said, we're just going to refactor. Don't change the code whatsoever. Don't change the behavior of the code. This seems sort of, it's the canonical, it's the definition of refactor, right? But it can be very compelling when you have lots of issues and bugs and things that you need to fix and functionality that you want to bring in to refactor and add a little bit more. Don't do that because it will make you completely crazy. You need to organize the code first. You have to have, and we had that. You know, we had a module-based system and we had already some functional programming aspects in the code. We focused on our pain points. So the bid, request, and response cycle, we wanted, as you saw from Matt, this was a lot of async stuff going on with a timer. And depending on when things came back and the order that things came back, different things might happen. So this was an area that we wanted to refactor for sure. Also with the targeting, I'll talk a little bit about that later on, just before the ad server call is made. And make sure you have comprehensive test coverage. You have to be able to demonstrate at the end of your refactor that, in fact, you have the same functionality. And this pattern I call the raw toe GKY pattern. Some of you are familiar with this pattern. It's the repairing the airplane while you're taking off and Google's trying to kill you. Now, I know that, you know, this is a good pattern for software design. Software engineering is don't take yourself too seriously. So I know that Google doesn't want to kill me. And if I was really curious about it, I could just, OK, Google, do you want to kill me? I wouldn't do that. That's going to screw up your profile. You shouldn't do that. Functional JavaScript. Functional JavaScript, right? So yeah, I know it's cute. I'm JavaScript kicking sand in Haskell's face. JavaScript is functional-ish. Haskell, of course, is a functional language. But our objective in doing the functional JS was to reduce debt, reduce lines of code, better handle an evented async programming model, be better prepared for growing rapidly. And we also found it just really cool. So it's a huge topic, right? And how are we going to apply this to, in a practical way, to a library that is raw JS, no frameworks or other libraries, not even Lodash or jQuery. So this is the approaches that we took. First of all, use arrays as your data structures because the functional methods of the array object in JS, ES6, and plus work on arrays. Use those functions, those methods like map, reduce, filter, find. Minimize your data structures. I'm going to go back to this bitter map. So this is a map, perfectly fine data object, and whereby we're collecting the bids for AppNexus for each of our bidders, right? So here's the AppNexus bids, here's the Sovereign bids, here's the Rubicon bids, and if I want the AppNexus bids, I can just say, here's my map, pass in a key, and here's your AppNexus bids. If you were going to express this in a more functional style, what you want to do is analyze the system, and you want to find what are the base constituent parts of this part of your system. So in our case, it's bids. So we just have an array of bids. Anytime we need to derive that, we write off the page there a little bit, but we just filter our bids object. So what you're doing is every time you need to get that value, you go back to your source data structures, you project that value, and ideally you wouldn't even necessarily stash it in this variable. You would always get it from your original source objects, source data objects. And if you follow this style, first of all, it might seem counterintuitive because you think, but that's inefficient. I already did all that work. Nothing changed. So why would I want to do all that work again? The code doesn't mind, first of all. Second of all, in the browser, arrays have gotten much faster to deal with. And all of your concurrency issues will, not all of your concurrency issues, lots of concurrency issues and race conditions simply go away. You just don't have to deal with them if every time I want that sovereign bids, I just derive it from the original source. So additional bids that came in, I don't have to say, hey, do I have more bids now? And do I have to regenerate that value? I just generate it every time. Functional style is declarative. So imperative statements, a logical switch, an if statement where you say, hey, if this is true, go do this thing. And if this other thing is true, go do that other thing. We put data first, so a functional style function takes one value in, another value out. We're not strict about this at all, as you'll see. But then basically write the data first, and then you start running operations on your data, and then you have your return value. Lodash now has data first variants of a lot of their methods. But the jQuery style is somewhat different from that, where they are using chaining, but they're doing it by passing an object that has methods through, and the data that's being operated on may be some part of that object or even outside of the scope of your function. Return fast. So this isn't functional style necessarily, but I like to, after the function signature, write a return statement. It just gets me thinking about, we want to cut to the chase here. We don't want intermediate states. We don't want a model, in our case, where we have a fairly simple task at hand, and we don't want to model a lot of intermediate stuff so that we understand the problem. We want to get the job done as quickly as possible and as few characters as possible, keep the file size down. So then here's a function that I can use to get any set of bidders anytime I want, bids for bidders. Now I'm kind of saying, hey, destructuring in ES6 works well here. So that's a single object that I'm passing in, and I'm kind of getting two values passed in with it, which is cheating, I suppose, but that's okay. Well, the other thing that you're also going to see here, though, is you could rewrite this really easily in a partial application. You could say, I'm going to pass in bids and return a function that takes a bidder. And then I'm going to pass in, now I've bound bids to that new function that I returned. And then I'm going to pass in another function. I'm going to call that function again, this time passing the bidder. And then that would be partial application. Or you could do currying, which would take what this, it's sort of hinting at that, where you just, hey, I got bids and bidder. I'm going to return a function that deals with bids and a function that deals with bidder. Here is the expanded auction piece as it is today. And I want to illustrate this as a way in which to just say that this is far from perfect. We have lambdas, anonymous functions, in here. We have some named functions that are in here. I'm going to talk quite a bit about lambdas, and I'm going to propose that in functional programming, this is wrong to say. Functional programming don't use lambdas. What? Don't use anonymous functions. Actually, anonymous functions are a feature of functional programming in many respects. However, you can't test those functions. You can't reuse those functions. So a great practice is to simply not use lambdas, name your functions, and then use function composition. Function composition, of course, is just composing functions, lower level functions that do things very simply. So if you're wondering, as you're working on this problem, hey, I've got some logic that I need to work out, maybe you need smaller functions, and then compose those functions up. I want to talk a little generally about functional programming, and this is interesting because there is a sense I think that folks have, that I had, that functional initially when I became introduced to it, that functional programming was this evolution of an idea. And that's exactly backwards. This huge cloud of words are all of the concepts that I'm not really talking about very much. So there's a lot more out there, and we're excited to bring, you know, more of these principles to the mix. We're also full speed ahead with adding functionality, fixing bugs, adding new bidders, adding new kinds of bidder, kinds of adapters, as we'll see. So it's a doable thing. You can use it. And people say, and they're correct, that to get the real goodness out of functional programming, you really kind of need to do the whole system that way. I have found that we got great great utility out of it. We cut our code base in half. We have a more readable code base. It's more understandable to the team. Lots of other things that we like about it. So once you understand all those words, you understand the right way of doing it. I don't do the right way, but it still works. So the lambda, though, I wanted to look at this 14th letter of the Greek alphabet, I think. Lambda comes to us from Alonzo Church, who invented lambda calculus. And when I figured that out, the whole idea of partial application and currying and some of these other things just kind of clicked. It's more like algebra. It's basically saying that a function is a first-class object and that a function is a value. So you can solve for x, and y is a function that you'll evaluate later. And doing that suddenly makes a lot of problems easier to think about and easier to solve. You're solving it. You're taking a complex problem, breaking it down to smaller problems. One of Alonzo Church's students was Alan Turing. So, and lambda calculus, by the way, is Turing complete. So it's safe to say that lambda calculus was Turing complete before Turing complete was a thing. Because I think he came up with it in Alonzo. Oh, awesome. So which came first? Within months. Lambda calculus and then Turing, because Turing's complete computational systems. So there you go. Thank you. And afterwards, oh, I see. Okay, great. So actually, if you didn't hear, Alan Turing was not a student of Alonzo Church. He came up with his Turing computational system and then became a student of Alonzo Church. Thanks for straightening me out there. We're going to talk about Fortran after the talk. So come find me, because I love some Fortran. Here in the targeting section, like 1, 2, 3, 4 lines down here, where var targeting, you can see the composition starting to come together. Hey, I want to get the winning bid targeting. I want to set targeting now on my ad slots. I want to find out what happened. Get winning bid targeting is the auction. Always use bid targeting is there's all the other bidders that were in that auction. I'm sorry, send all bids. Here I'm kind of cheating. I'm getting a logical in there with a ternary operation to say, hey, I'm going to check this global. This is not functional programming. It's like they can live like right next to each other. It's amazing. But you can compare this to where you can read this readable function to the bit below it, where it's a lot harder to kind of even understand what might be going on there. So back to a year in pre-bid. In April, Google announces EBDA, exchange, bidding, dynamic allocation. This is going to kill header bidding, or it's going to be an answer to header bidding. In May, our FP refactor lands. And in June, we continued. And now we're talking about the end of header bidding, because Google's got EBDA coming down the pike. That was in April. We survived. In June, the rise of header bidding was still a story. And in July, something really interesting happened, which is that we released a analytics API. And we did it in the same style that we handled bidders, which is through an adapter system. And I say that's really interesting because we were taking this this way in which it, we're handling bitters and saying, well, let's do that again with adapters. And why that's interesting is that, oh, we could do that with anything else too. And so the extensibility here of this project starts to reveal itself as something that is perhaps more like, well, the way that Mozilla and Firefox kind of is a reference implementation, but this is also kind of enabling some stuff. So it's interesting. This is sort of growing up into something. And in August, Facebook comes out with their own header bidder. In September, Google boosts the ABDA offering. In October, with continued growth, and starting to see now a volume, so the AppNexus platform seeing 13 billion impressions a day, a volume of impressions from across the publisher landscape. And it started, so the pattern there, I started to think, well, that's kind of, you know, it's enabling a market that didn't exist before. And it's enabling it because it is open source. It wouldn't work otherwise. It wouldn't be the same thing. So it's a little bit more like this blockchain pattern where, you know, you couldn't do the kinds of things that you can do with Bitcoin before Bitcoin. And I thought that was pretty cool. AOL announces their own wrapper. They had a bidder in header bidding for forever, but they decided to, hey, we're going to come out with our own wrapper to wrap other demand as well. And Prebid usage actually dipped in October a little bit. That existential crisis never goes away, right? And it's like, okay, it's an existential crisis every day. You know, this might be the end of your project or not. And you just got to show up record code. So this issue of parallelism and the perception that JavaScript is terrible at parallelism, and you know, I mean, he's not wrong, but he's not right twice here, because JavaScript doesn't do parallelism; it's a single-threaded model, unless you want to talk about web workers. But that's just simply another kind of process, in a sense, pseudo process. So. The volume of transactions, the number of auctions that we run, and we don't know, but you know, it's somewhere between a million or more per second, probably quite a bit more, because we're running the auctions in the browsers. So we can do a million plus, 2 million, 3 million, I don't know, auctions per second at no cost. Or rather, because of the massively distributed nature of the project, those costs are defrayed to ad networks, to individuals on your cell phones. So there may be some other things that are going on here that are actually making this technology more competitive, not just the quote-unquote Google tax, not just the fact that, there might be some other things going on there. So the pattern that I want to leave you with, which is where we're kind of finding ourselves today, which is really exciting, is a kind of platform. So if you have an idea that can enhance the ad call, and I mean not a bidder necessarily, not analytics necessarily, it could be anything, right? Anything that can take place in this marketplace, if you have some innovation that you want to bring into this marketplace, and if you want to compete in an arena where the rules are fair and the mechanics are transparent and the barrier to entry is gone, then we love pull requests. Thanks. I would like to bring up Eric Hoffert now to talk about service server and pre-bid video.
Thanks a lot, Nate. All right. We're going to take a quick look at this topic before we jump to the video world. So, you've heard quite a bit about pre-bid, functional programming, it's pretty wild. Just as a quick refresher for client-side header bidding, the auction mechanics are, remember the browser is basically making requests to a whole series of SSPs that are running auctions in parallel, and then the results are coming back from that, actually in those beautiful bids arrays that you just saw from Nate in the functional programming context. And that gives you that full transparency, by the way, because you can see all the bids when they come back. And then that set of bids comes back to the browser, and you take the top price, and then you can take that top price, and you can render it as a creative in the browser, and you can be done. Or you can take it and you can pass it along with the creative and the price together with an ad server tag, and you send it to the ad server, where it then will pick, using its own decisioning logic, what it should use, direct demand or basically auction-based demand, in order to get the best price and the best result. So that's kind of a recap for you of the mechanics of client-side header bidding. So for server-to-server, also called S2S, it's conceptually similar. The distinction here is that when the browser makes the request, it's going to a server instead, a single server, and that server in turn is then making possibly a very large number of requests to other individual SSPs, each of which is running their own auction, returning the result to the server-to-server wrapper, which is then returning that single result, which is a price, back to the browser. So one of the benefits that's been cited of this approach is the potential reduction of latency, because you're pushing all of those, the ranking process, and pushing all of the bids that get ranked in the browser with that distributed parallelism you heard about from Nate, and you're pushing it onto a server. So it has the potential to reduce latency, but it does have a trade-off, which is you possibly can have issues with what's called user syncing or user match in terms of cookies and identifying users by doing this in this manner. That is definitely one risk. And then the other is you want to have that same degree of transparency you get with getting a full bids array back on the client that you saw from previous speakers. You want to make sure you can still do that in a server-to-server context. That said, we do think this is a really exciting and interesting direction as a complement to client-side header bidding. We think there's a lot of interesting things still to come, so watch this space for server-to-server and this type of auction mechanics as part of the broader framework we've been talking with you about here today. All right, like I said before, I am a video guy, and I think it's time for us to talk about video and how does video relate to header bidding. So first of all, you heard me speak earlier about how AppNexus, as a company, wants to create a better internet as part of our mission. Well, for the video team and for AppNexus with its video initiative, we're looking to create a better video internet. So what does that mean more specifically? Well, if you think about it, we're at this really interesting inflection point where TV budgets are massive. And online video budgets are there and growing, but there's still a huge opportunity to move television onto the web. But for us to do that successfully, you need to be able to reduce video latency, and in particular, you need to be able to slash the amount of time it takes to load video ads if you want to get to the fluidity that you have on the TV in your living room. The second is we really want to drive towards higher levels of personalization and relevance for video, so that if you're a snowboarder, you'll see a snowboarder ad instead of an ad to go to Thailand. And we heard already that from a benefit standpoint, we're trying to push more revenue to publishers. In this case, it's video publishers and broadcasters. And also, we want to help marketers be able to better reach their target audience. And then finally, there's just a goal to be able to create more engaging and fun video formats as part of this next generation video internet. Just a bit about me and my background. As I said, I'm a video guy. I actually came initially from Apple, where I had the incredible opportunity and fun experience of building QuickTime, which was great. But this was actually before software digital video existed. Pretty amazing adventure. More recently, I worked at Spotify as a video architect, advice as a digital video architecture consultant, JW Player as the chief technology officer, and a place called AT&T Bell Labs, where I was able to build graphics supercomputers from scratch. So I've done all this work, which I've really loved, in visual computing and video. And one of the things I've noticed, especially over the last 5 years, is that video monetization is potentially a bottleneck to kind of realizing this vision of fast, fluid TV-type experiences on the open internet. And so that's one of the reasons I actually joined AppNexus. Brian O'Kelly, our CEO, gave me the opportunity to come here and work on this with an amazing team. And it's been a great adventure so far. We'll continue pushing forward to get to that vision of a better video internet. So let's now talk about video header bidding and how that relates. So for one thing, similar to display header bidding is video SSP demand competes with video ad server demand. Same concept there. Here's where things start to get different. So for one thing, from an architectural principle standpoint, we believe that having an open video architecture is extremely important for video header bidding to work. And one of the reasons is the video world is actually really fragmented. You have, for example, a huge number of different video players. There's maybe 5 or 10 that are really popular, but there's proprietary players, company-specific open source players. And what we want to do with this vision of Prebid.js and open source is actually support as many of those as possible. So video player independence is a key principle behind what we're doing. The second, which is similar to display, is video demand source independence. And you've heard about how Prebid.js for display has 40 adapters. There's a goal to get to a large number of adapters and demand partners for video. I'll talk a little bit about that later and where we are. And then the third is video ad server independence. DFP is very dominant in the display world. In the video world, you have a number of other video ad servers that are out there. And we'd like to provide a technical framework so that people who are working with different video ad servers and this community have the ability to interoperate with those for header bidding. So this is not just a DFP-only capability. Low latency and user experience I spoke about. This is also interesting because you may read articles. In fact, there are a couple over the course of the last week challenging whether video header bidding can actually impact latency adversely and slow things down. And we'll talk about that statement and how it relates to the work that's being done. And again, the goal here is to drive towards a TV-like fluidity on the open video internet. And then there's a methodology independence objective here, which is that you should be able to do with video, which you've heard about with display, and ultimately have the flexibility to use either client or server-side header bidding, depending on the context for the publisher implementation that you're working on. So by a show of hands, how many of you have ever seen this before? Okay, that's good. I would hope that actually over time the number of raised hands goes down each year, and I think it is starting to, which is a promising sign for getting to a better video internet. But the reality is a lot of video ads can take anywhere from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 seconds or more to load. And this is what I was talking about, how it can really be an impediment to getting to a strong video user experience. So it's definitely to break what we call the video speed barrier and get to a point of lower latency for video publishers. So now let's talk a little bit about how we do this. So one thing that you heard about earlier is a deadline-driven environment, which is what header bidding is based on, where you basically set a deadline for your buyers. For example, if it's gonna take 4 seconds to get your video demand, let's set a deadline of 700 milliseconds, and the only people who get to serve are the people who can provide you with demand in 700 milliseconds. I know it sounds like a pipe dream, but that is the goal. And that's actually how it works. The other thing is to run video auctions away from the play button. This is actually a really important point because typically when you click play on a video player, that's when you're making a request to a video ad server to serve your creative, as well as run any kind of process to ask for demand from multiple sources. And that's one of the reasons you get that buffering and latency experience that I just showed you a minute ago. So we want to work hard to avoid that with any approach that we take to video header bidding. The third is if you actually successfully source video demand and you do it really quickly, you should cache that so you have it available to use it when the user clicks play or at some subsequent time. And then finally, you have to actually think about the logic and the timing. You actually need to synchronize the start of playback of the video with the return of the ad. For example, you don't wanna start playing the video prematurely if the ad isn't gonna come until much later. So you have to take this into account and think about the synchronization and timing issues for video. And this aspect of header bidding, by the way, doesn't exist at all for display. So it's a whole nother layer and dimension you have to consider if you're a video publisher and you're using video header bidding. One thing that's been exciting about this is we have, as part of the Prebid project, put out on the Prebid.js site, and encourage you to look at the recent blog post, which is about video, a whole series of code examples for different video players. So there's examples out there for JW Player, for Video.js, for Brightcove, for Kaltura, for Ooyala, An integration has been done by another video player company called Playwire. And this is really just the beginning. Because it's open source, back to what you've heard from, you know, Nate and Matt, there's an opportunity to extend this to a large number of other video players, including video players you might build yourselves from scratch. So that compatibility is important to create a more generalized solution. All right, let's take a minute before we go to the demos and just talk a bit about the steps that are involved in doing this. So step one is to create a video ad unit to bid on. And when you do that, you need to specify the parameters that are relevant for your video content. Is it skippable? Does a user click to play? Is it autoplay? What are the dimensions of the video player size? So you have to put all that specification into your video ad unit. The second is you need to receive a winning bid, which you've heard about from both client-side and server-side methods, from your demand partners and pass it to the video player. In the example you see here, this is setting a 700 millisecond deadline for the video demand. You see the bids array, which we talked about before, which passes back all the bids. And then there's a callback function called bidsback handler that gets called when the bids are ready and returned from the demand partners. You then pass in the name of your ad server, the video ad unit that I just showed you in the previous slide, and then you form what's called a master video ad server tag. And that includes, effectively, again, the price, the creative, and the tag that the ad server needs to operate correctly to be able to handle the decisioning logic around choosing the open auction demand or the direct demand. And then you'll see there's a call to the video player called invoke video player. The final step is to actually play the video ad and the video content. And you'll see there's two scenarios here, one of which is called pre-page load and one of which is called post-page load. So in the pre-page load scenario, this would be if the video demand comes back very quickly. Let's say it comes back in 300 milliseconds. In that case, you call invoke video player, and you basically just store the video creative reference, it's vast XML, until you need it. In the second scenario, the entire page has loaded, the video demand has returned, and so you'll see an invoke video player function that sets up the video player, attaches the video advertising to it, and then makes a call to basically play the ad before the content. So that just shows you the two different scenarios and gets into some of the timing issues to make this work properly. Final point is building demand adapters. So there's a section on the Prebid.js website about how to do this. You, of course, name your adapter. Export a function called call bids. There's a step to basically register your bid response when it comes back and give it the video attributes that are important, like player size, X and Y dimensions, and the URL, most importantly, that's pointing to the vast video creative. And also you indicate that video is a supported media type. So that's a quick crash course on video header bidding and how it works. And now, in the spirit of taking maximum risk, it's time for some live demos of video to show you how this works. Just as a quick note, this is the blog post, which was written by Matt Jacobson on the Prebid team about video header bidding. It's the most up-to-date blog post on the site, so if you want to learn more, feel free to check that out. And then there's a set of links to different examples, which I was referring to. Okay, so while I loaded that page, that's when we ran effectively the pre-bid auction to source this video ad creative, which happens to be a personal favorite. Prohibit, the hibbit to the hip, hip, hop it, you don't stop, the rocket to the bang, bang, boogie, set up, jump, the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to be. Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rocking to the beat, and we, the groove, and the... Okay, hope you enjoyed the rollerblading babies. They're now up to 90 million views on YouTube, by the way. And then you'll notice when we skip to the content, it plays seamlessly and quickly. In this case, this is actually an open source video file, an open source player, and rollerblading babies to show you the content before. But what happened here is, again, we asynchronously made the request for the video demand partners on page load, so that by the time that I clicked play, that video ad was already cached and effectively available immediately to be sourced into the video player. And that's one of the ways that you can cut latency. Just another example, more to just to show the flexibility. As you can see, a lot of the Major players are supported. This is an example from Kaltura, which is also has an open source option along with it. And same idea, ad comes up quickly, and then the video content. Final example is the most demanding, and I think in many ways the most interesting. So if you think about it, on the web, what you just saw was examples of a pre-roll video and then video content. But on a lot of sites, you have video playlists. So a video playlist is an ad to support the content, then the editorial content, then an ad, then the content, then an ad, then a content in a monetization perspective. So in this example, all of that is happening with video header bidding. And when the page loaded, it ran the first auction for the demand, and then it sourced this other wonderful video commercial, which may have some familiar figures in it for you from the previous commercial. While this ad is running, it's already sourced the video demand for the next ad in this playlist, which is often called a mid-roll. So the video ad for the mid-roll is already available, even though we haven't gotten to it yet. And here's our friends again. This time they're surfing. And you'll see that the latency has been really low. It's been low to load the first ad, it's been low to add the content, and then if I skip to the next ad, it should be similarly quick, and that's because you don't have to go out and source the content. Now, one thing I should mention that's a caveat with all of this is that in some cases, people try and run what are called secondary auctions in the video ad itself. At AppNexus, we have a process called creative audit, where the what are called ad managers will often be removed from the audit process, which means they won't be able to run another auction if they can't guarantee you fill when you're using video content in this way. And I think that's important to mention because that could add a lot of additional latency if you have an ad manager running that you've run an auction for already through Prebid. So that's a scenario you typically would want to avoid in terms of being able to minimize latency.